If you're going through a divorce or thinking about going through a divorce, you are definitely going to want to listen to today's podcast. My special guest, Wendy Sterling, is going to share some of her diamond gems on how to reclaim your voice when you're going through a divorce, steps to having self-care, and definitely some takeaways at the end that you are going to want to hear. How would it feel to lose 40 pounds, even when you're over 40? You are a smart woman. You know you need to move more and eat less, but why don't you do it? Or maybe you think you are doing all the things and still not seeing the results you want. If this is the case, you are in the right place. Welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. I'm your host, Nicole Simonin, and I help women over 40 lose weight for the last time. This podcast will teach you all about fitness, nutrition, and most importantly, your mindset. Plus, we have some special guests stop by to share their stories. Now on to today's show. Hey everybody, welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. I am sitting down with a very special guest today. We are gonna be talking about self-care while going through divorce. And my special guest today is Wendy Sterling. And Wendy is a divorce recovery specialist, a writer, an author, and speaker who founded the Divorce Rehab. Wendy helps divorced women recover from their divorce by finding their true identity and voice by ending their pity party, mourning the loss of their marriage to create a better and new life that they design. So Wendy, so welcome to the podcast. I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you. I'm so honored to be here. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I find it funny because we only really met, like, it's probably been 2 or 3 weeks. And I feel like we've been friends forever.
Right? Kind of weird. Isn't it? Yeah. I love that.
I think we have a lot in common, and we have a lot of similar thoughts and drive, I think, and I think that's why we are so connected. So I am so thrilled that you're on today. And before we dive into the topic, I want everyone to know that Wendy has a free private Facebook group called The Divorce Rehab. And she also has a podcast, The Divorced Woman's Guide, and that is available on iTunes, Spotify, and YouTube. You can get all this information at Wendy's website at wendysterling.net, and you can also get it on the show notes at shapeitupfitness.com. All right, so Wendy, tell the listeners a little bit about your story that catapulted you into your coaching business.
Sure, I'm happy to. So as you said, I mean, I really believe that divorce can be an empowering experience that women go through to find their true identity and voice so that they can actually start designing a life that they love instead of feeling stuck in the one that they have. And I often work with divorced women who struggle with so much noise around what is next, right? And who they are and how they're just going to get through each day. And unfortunately, a lot of them have lost a lot of hope in finding joy, in finding love and finding peace again in their own life. And I will never forget the day that I was driving home from a couple's night out with my husband at the time, and it was 11:45 at night. And his phone rang 5 times from the same woman. And I remember clear as day the punch I felt in my gut at that moment, which told me that something was wrong. And tears started streaming down my face. And even though we had been in therapy for couples therapy for many years, I knew that I had to trust my gut and look outward like I had been taught to do, or excuse me. And instead of looking outward like I had been taught to do my entire life, I knew that I needed to listen to my intuition. And so for the first time in my marriage, I really stood in my power and I confronted him. And unfortunately, what he denied, you know, I had to go prove, and I did. Mm. And unfortunately, my gut punch was correct. You know, I remember the day that I asked him for the divorce. It felt very freeing, but I was also terrified because what I had realized was that when I looked at myself in the mirror, I had no idea who was staring back at me anymore. And that was because I had really lost myself in my marriage and I had only seen my reflection through his eyes. And so it struck me that most of my life I had been, you know, as a nice little girl, taught not to speak, listen, smile, and base decisions off of what other people told me. Mm. And unfortunately, I'd created that own dynamic in my marriage, which I got to own. And I realized that I didn't know who I was outside of being a mother and a life. And so I knew that that day was a big day for me because I stood in my power and realized that I needed to create a life for Wendy. So thinking about the future was really scary. And thankfully, you know, the universe works in mysterious ways. And I saw a post from a friend on Facebook and something about it clicked inside of me. And I knew that there was something more for me that had to do with this post. And so I called her and lo and behold, 3 hours later, signed up for the course and also started being coached because I had been in therapy and wasn't moving forward. And I really knew that this was going to be something special. And so for the next year, not only did I learn from coaching experts on how to transform my life and to how to help other people, but I was also starting to see the shifts in my mindset as a result of the tools that I was being gifted. And at that moment, I knew that transformation was possible for me. And at no point in my life had I ever felt more free in seeing what was possible. And in that next year, I really spent a lot of time with my coach reclaiming my identity. And what struck me was that I could combine the 20 years of corporate America experience that I had had with this new coaching methodology to really start making more of an impact in this world and become an entrepreneur. And it was insane because it was almost like I had this epiphany of this new calling, and I knew that I was being brought forward to make a change in the world for more women like me. And so I left corporate America and I became a certified life coach, which I call myself a divorce recovery specialist. And what I do is I really help women understand that their divorce is a gift and it's something that is happening for them, not to them. And so at the end of the day, my 5-step program really takes them from a place of reclaiming their identity and voice, ending their pity party, helping them to heal their wounds, accept the new status of being single, and really start embracing their vision for their future. And so I heal women from divorce, right? Healing women from divorce is what I do, and really empowering them to reclaim their voice and identity, just like I did, to create their next best chapter is really who I am.
That's awesome. That's an incredible story. Just, you know, because I had heard the shorter version, I think, from you before, but I can't imagine the thoughts going through your head when the phone rang so much and just, you know, that's like everything bottoms out, you know, like your world just comes crashing around. And I think it's interesting too, like, because I am married and I know in the beginning of my marriage, there was a time where I wasn't my true self.
Yeah.
And I was the mom, the wife, the, you know, what was expected, exactly what you had said. And I think whether you're going through a divorce or whether you're married, women, we need to still connect to who we are and like not just these titles that are put on us or these expectations for whatever, you know, you're married, you're divorced, you're a mom, you're whatever. And I think that's interesting because, you know, I think like when you get to a divorce, you don't realize how lost you are and you're kind of forced to be like, this is who I am. And I don't know who that person is. And I love that saying you said, the person you are through your husband's eyes.
Yeah.
I think you need to quote that, like trademark that one.
Yes.
Okay. So let's dive into the topic today. So we're talking about self-care while going through divorce. So go ahead. I'll let you go ahead and start us off there, Wendy.
Sure. I mean, I think we start off with the fact that as moms, especially, you know, unfortunately, we are the last person that we think of, right? You know, we want to take care of everybody else and we put ourselves absolute last, especially when we're going through divorce. And part of that is because if you are a mom and you do have kids, you worry about the kids, and you're constantly concerned about them and you put yourself secondary. And unfortunately, that is kind of the opposite of what needs to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, as you and I were talking about this, even just yesterday, you know, it's the airplane example with the, you know, the oxygen mask. Well, when you're on an airplane and God forbid something goes wrong, they always tell you put your oxygen mask on first and then assist your kids. It's the same thing in divorce. You've got to be able to breathe before you can really help your kids, because you're coming from a place of panic and anxiety. And, you know, I even remember I put my kids first and I was short-tempered. I had no patience. I also wasn't taking care of myself. I wasn't eating and I was not being the best version of me. And as soon as I even flipped that script, I felt like I was, you know, I had more energy and I was able to do things. And I think that people believe that self-care is like this big monstrosity. It's this big weight of like, oh, I have to, self-care is like going for a massage and going for a mani-pedi or, you know, taking a vacation, right? Mm-hmm. It involves money. It involves expensive things. It involves time, which us divorcees don't always have a lot of, and money sometimes gets tight because assets get frozen once you go into a divorce, et cetera. And if you don't have your own source of income, it's a little stressful. Mm-hmm. And what I try to explain with my clients is that self-care can be things like taking a walk. It can be meditating for 5 minutes a day. And meditation can just be sitting outside or sitting in your room and just closing your eyes. Or, you know, self-care is listening to music. Self-care is painting. It's reading a book. It's journaling. It's these small little things. And even self-care is leaning into what's coming up for you. Mm. We try so hard to push aside the emotion, and that is actually worse for you. Part of what you get to do as self-care practice when you're going through a divorce is to allow yourself to feel, because it releases it for you.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yeah,
a saying that I heard, it's called when you resist, it persists.
Yes. What you resist, persists.
What you resist, persists. Yes. And yep. It's so true. It's so true. And I think we think if we let it go, that it's going to have the opposite effect, you know?
100%. And what ends up happening is like, you compress it down, and I call it the volcano effect, because the more you push it down, the more, like the bigger the explosion is going to be. Right. Yeah. And even just, you know, even on Mother's Day, right, I asked my boys, I was like, okay, tonight you guys are, you know, my kids are older. I'm like, you're putting yourselves to bed. I'm saying goodnight right now. Do not bother me unless somebody, you know, is an emergency. And it was really just telling my kids, leave me alone for an hour. Right. And I just wanted to have an hour to myself. And it wasn't just because it was Mother's Day. It's just, sometimes you just need to close the door and just sit, right? And that's self-care. It doesn't have to be that big. I'm a huge believer in small steps. Every small baby step moves you that much more forward, because what happens is if you set this grandiose goal, it's going to feel so much harder to get to, less attainable, versus imagine if you just took little teeny steps, you'll get there faster and it will be maintained, right? It'll become a habit versus just like a one-off impulse.
Yeah. This is very similar to what I teach my clients too, is, and it depends on the person, I think, because there are some people that can do big goals and like just have tunnel vision and go for it. But yeah. And I think a lot of people I know for the fitness side, the health and wellness is like you're saying, you can take like 5 minutes and do something. Like you can take 5 minutes and just go for a walk outside. That is propelling you forward. And I think people think they have to have these like grandiose big leaps, like as far as fitness, they feel like they have to go to flip tires. You don't have to go flip tires. Just get out and start moving your body.
Right.
Same thing. Yeah.
It is the same thing. And, you know, it's thinking about it differently, right? Because I think our minds have a definition of what self-care is supposed to look like. Right. And it's really about shifting your mindset around what that looks like and what it looks like for you, right? You talk about how you customize, you know, all of your programs for your clients. It's not a one size fits all. And it's the same thing with self-care, especially as it relates to divorce, because I have clients who initiate the divorce. I have clients who were cheated on. I have clients who were shocked in the middle of nowhere and had no idea this was coming for them. So circumstances also dictate what the best course of action is. But at the end of the day, you know what's best for you, right? And part of what I do with my clients is really get curious with them about the things that they love, the things that bring them joy, the things that they used to do that perhaps they don't do anymore, right? And, you know, I'll never forget, I had a client that I was working with, and you know, she was like, I can't, all I do is I sit all day and I do, you know, and I think about what he did and I think about this and I think about that. And I literally just asked her one simple question, which was like, what is something that you used to do that you truly loved that you haven't made time for? And she's an artist. And she said, well, I haven't painted. And so she came up with the idea of going out and buying an adult coloring book and just taking 10 minutes a day and just spending time reconnecting, right? And even that calmed her immediately. It's so different for everybody, but it doesn't have to be complicated.
Right. To that effect though, with the coloring book, this is not based on true science. Like, I'm sure there's evidence, but there is something about, and I forget which side of the brain it is. I think it's the left side that is coloring. There's something about shifting your right side from like the analytical, the one that ruminates, that side to the creative side. Because I know I used to draw. I haven't in a while, but there's something just like mesmerizing, and like it's almost like it shuts off that side of your brain and it gives you kind of like some peace and quiet.
Right.
Which is interesting. Sorry. A little side.
But it's totally true. And even, you know, dance parties, right? Just put on one of your, like, I love 80s music. And like when I need a pick me up or I just need a distraction, like I'll put on music and like I will force myself to stand up and just start dancing. Or sometimes I get in my car and I like blast music with the wind. I live in LA, so I can put the windows down more often than not, right? And I just put the windows down and I just listen to music and I like sing at the top of my lungs and I don't care who's listening or watching. You know, it can be anything that feels good to you, and it just lets your mind detach from, you know, what is happening with the divorce and just really fostering you. Because at the end of the day, you're not going to be able to give or to be your best self if you don't take care of yourself, right? If you want to find love again, that's great. But do you really love yourself? Do you remember what it is about you that you love? It starts within. You have to learn to love yourself. You have to learn to trust yourself, right? And you can't do any of that if you are not nurturing your mind, your body, and your soul. You have to come first. You have to. And, you know, I also remember telling my kids, like, I love you guys, but like, this is what I need, even if you're home, right? I have my kids 50% of the time. And even while they're here, I need breaks during the day. And I constantly remind them, I'm like, you know, when you think your brother's annoying you, like, and you just want to go to your room and shut the door. I'm like, so I need that from you guys too. Like you get annoyed with him every day and you go to your room and you close the door. Well, guess what? I get to have that too. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And I think that we also don't give our kids enough credit in terms of not only how resilient they are, but how smart they are. They get it. And, you know, and understandably, if you have younger kids, like there's a slightly different learning curve that has to happen there, but there's different ways that you can also express to your children that like, you just need some time. You just need, you know, you need to feel good about yourself because, you know, as kids, they do it whenever they want. They get to play for a living. Right. And yes, they go to school and all of that, but like, you know, they feel good and they feel free and their mind is somewhere else when they're, you know, doing art or, you know, mind play video games, you know, and we get to treat ourselves to that too.
I think that's a good role model too for your kids. Cause when they see you taking care of yourself, it's going to, you know, cause I think somewhere along the line, I feel like there's a shift in, you know, you're a kid and you get to do whatever you want. And now all of a sudden you're an adult and you can't do what you want, or you can't take that time. Like you have responsibilities and not to say that you don't, but you know, I think that the adult, like expectations are sometimes a little bit like, we can go have fun, you can go on the playground and, you know, swing on the monkey bars or swing on the swing, that kind of
thing. Yeah. We get to be kids too. Yeah. I mean, I was just reading, or I should say listening to the audiobook, Rachel Hollis's, Girl, Stop Apologizing. I read that one a while ago.
Yeah.
Girl, Stop Apologizing. And one of the things that she talks about in there is that like we get to tap into our own inner toddler, right? With the curiosity that they have in the world, with the, even though that they fail, they get back up and they try it again, right?
Yeah.
And as adults, we don't give ourselves that wiggle room, right? We don't let ourselves be the little boy or girl that still lives within us. And sometimes we need to bring them out, right? And they get to play.
Sometimes when we fall as adults, we don't always get back up because when we fall and it's just comfortable. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think when you have to stand back up, no matter what you're doing, it's uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And it's hard. So like if you're going through a divorce and you're constantly getting pummeled by different things that are going on, I think that people need to realize that you can't level up when you're in comfort. Like,
correct,
discomfort is what
levels
the currency
up
to your dreams, basically.
No, it is. And it's very true. I mean, and even with self-care, it's uncomfortable because you feel discomfort putting yourself first. You know, I've been reading a lot of books lately, Glennon Doyle, new book, Untamed. She talks all about how we need to be more selfish. And it's not a negative thing, but we feel that it's a negative thing. So we don't do it. We think self-care is selfish,
right?
And it's not. And, you know, you get to take care of yourself because no one else is going to take care of you. You have to take care of yourself. And as women, we get to stand in the power of knowing that we can be independent. And unfortunately, divorce doesn't provide that mindset right away because you're so used to being part of a couple. And then all of a sudden you're a party of one and you feel sort of, you get knocked down, right?
Yeah.
And the self-care that you need to pick yourself back up feels really heavy. It feels uncomfortable. It feels really scary. Mm. But on the other side of it is growth. There's so much opportunity on the other side of it. But you've got to take care of yourself in order to get there. That's part of the journey, right? That's part of how you move forward.
Yeah. And as much as I love Disney, I think they kind of spoiled us ladies for marriage in the sense that
princess,
it should be happily ever after. And, you know, you're Prince Charming and all that. And then reality sets in. It's not always that way. But yeah.
No, it's not. I mean, and I think that's a great example. I mean, that talks to my whole point of when I was growing up, I was taught to smile, sit pretty, and find a, you know, marry a doctor or a lawyer. And, you know, ironically, I married the lawyer, but, you know, regardless, like we were taught that those were the gender specific, you know, qualities
roles,
that we were taught from a very young age.
So, can you share a little bit about where you are now with your ex-husband? And I only bring this up because I know the answer and I think it would be helpful if everyone heard.
Sure. So, you know, I will say we did not have an amicable beginning to our divorce. And it really was only until really only a couple of months ago that things shifted. And we now have, I think, one of the best relationships we've ever had with one another. You know, we had been together, we were married for 15 years. We had met when we were 18. We spent half of our adult life together. He was my best friend. And so, you know, we've been able to get ourselves back to a place where we're able to co-parent from a place of being friendly. And to me, that is a huge win because, you know, again, as everybody could read between the lines of my story, I was knocked on the ground, shocked, foundation gone. I mean, he really did a number on me. And the fact that I've come to this place of being able to take responsibility for, you know, I don't take responsibility for the bad choice that he made. However, I do take responsibility for my part in our marriage breaking down, and having done that and him and I having a couple of heart-to-heart conversations around what responsibility looks like for each of us, it's really made a huge difference. And my kids feel it. You know, they are overjoyed with how we have been getting along. And, you know, not that we ever put them in the middle, but like kids are smart, like they can feel the tension. So it's made a really big difference. And a lot of that is because I've done the work. And, you know, I can't say that he has. I don't know what he has or hasn't done.
I think as long as it's one person, you're good. But, do you know what I mean? Like one person that does the work.
But, and that's all that it takes, right? Yeah. Because you can only control yourself, and I don't let him push my buttons anymore. And I had to learn how to set my boundaries to be able to not let him do that anymore. And I've gotten really good at it. And it's not that I only did that a couple of months ago. It's more that, you know, there's different firsts that continue to keep coming up. And, you know, I think that's also one of the things that gets really hard, you know, for divorcees also is, you know, picking yourself back up after you know, have some firsts. Like my ex-husband's already remarried. He had a baby. So I have been, it has been like a constant, you know, having to kind of get back up and get back up and get back up. The important part is that I have the tools now to be able to do it. It's just that he and I were never in a place for us to really, he was very focused on his life instead of working on what our relationship looked like. So once he got his new life set, there was an opportunity for us to figure out how this was going to work. So, you know, I just want to caution people, like, it's not, you know, it's circumstantial with how it wound up that way, but I'm beyond blessed and happy. Now I don't get anxiety picking up the phone or if I hear him calling, you know, and we also don't call each other. We typically email. So, you know, it just makes
legally,
it a lot easier.
That's probably better.
Yes. There's that there's little that added too. Side too. Yes.
Yeah. Well, yes. I want to thank you so much for sharing your story because, you know, I think even though we repeat our stories, it's still, you relive it every time, you know, you tell your tale. So, but yes. If anyone out there is thinking about divorce or is in the middle of divorce, Wendy offers a 30-minute free divorce recovery support call. You can schedule an appointment at wendysterling.net. And tell me a little bit about the summit that you're having in June, right? June or July?
June. Yep. Launches June 9th. So I am creating a free summit for women who are in divorce process or even on the other side. And I did my first summit in February and I'm doing one again because, you know, one of the things that I wish that I had were these types of resources all in one place. And I have, you know, I'm very blessed in that I have a lot of friends within the divorce community. We are a lot stronger together. We've all been swimming in our own lanes. And I really believe in the power of us coming together. And so what I am doing with the summit is not only bringing this community together, I'm bringing them together and giving access to anybody, anywhere for free to come and listen to different 30-minute interviews that I am having. So the summit, the summit is called Beyond Divorce, Discover the Secrets to Disconnect, Set Boundaries, and Move Forward. And the experts that I'm going to be having on are going to be covering topics like co-parenting, narcissism, health and wellness.
I think I know that person that's going to do health and wellness.
I was going to say, and Nicole's going to be a guest. She's one of my guests that I interviewed. I have lawyers, I have mediators, I have podcasters, TEDx speakers, authors, I mean, you name it. And everybody is going to be talking about a different area of expertise to help you move forward. Given the way of the world right now, everybody's feeling very stuck because courts are closed. Things are moving very slowly. There's going to be a massive backup when the world opens back up, you know, and I'm sure it's going to be done very slowly. And so a lot of people feel like they can't move forward. They feel stuck. And part of my message for the summit is for them to understand that the business side is on hold, but the emotional side, the mental side gets to move you forward. And if you focus on that today, it's actually going to benefit you long-term and when the courts open back up, because you're going to be coming from a place of, you know, you'll be coming from a more rational place in your decision-making. It'll save you money with your lawyers, because so many times, you know, we vent to our lawyers like they're therapists. And so the summit is really meant to give you some nuggets of information for you to just move yourself forward in some way. And all of my experts are giving free gifts. Everybody has been overly generous. You know, we give to give. There's no strings attached. This entire summit is free. You just have to register for it. And, you know, Nicole, like I said, is one of my experts. So she'll be sending out information to figure out how to get registered for it. And honestly, it's going to be amazing. It's going to be a video a day. It's going to span over the course of 4 weeks. I have 25 experts locked in at this point. So it's going to be, I mean, I know it's my summit, but it really is going to be phenomenal. The conversations that I have been having are so informative. And so I've had aha moments during each of these interviews, and that's awesome. It's been awesome.
That's really cool. So I'm looking forward to that. And that is happening in June. So again, you can go to wendysterling.net for information, and you can also check out the show notes. And if you are on my email list or in my social media networking area, you will definitely be hearing about it. So that is for sure. All right, Wendy. So we're now on to the speed round, which is everyone's favorite part.
I can't wait.
All right. So I'm going to throw in a question just because we talked about it. What is your favorite 80s band?
Oh, so easy. Bon Jovi.
Oh, yeah. I think he's from Jersey, isn't he? I
think so.
Yeah. I have a client who is like a mega Bon Jovi fan. It's really kind of funny.
As am I. And I went to a concert like 6 months pregnant with my oldest. And when he would fuss in the car, I would put on Bon Jovi and it quieted him down.
Oh, wow. So, he's the baby whisperer. He's my baby.
Little does he know.
Right. Awesome. All right. So question number two, what is your favorite place to vacation?
Oh, Maui.
Ooh.
It's my happy place. I actually own a timeshare there and I go there every year.
Very cool.
It is my happiest place on earth.
Well, I keep forgetting you're in California, so the flight isn't as horrible as it's like for me.
Right. It's only a 5-hour flight.
Oh, yeah. That's nice. Yeah. Yes. It's like 13 hours or something crazy with the layovers. I have been to Hawaii a long time ago. I went when I was 13 and it's beautiful. And I still, my husband and I say we want to go. We went to Australia a couple years ago. And I always say I want to go to like California and stay for like, this is when we're older, 2 weeks. Then go to Hawaii, spend like 2 or 3 weeks there, and then go
just
to like,
island hop.
Yeah, New Zealand, and then hit Australia again because Sydney was incredible. It was really loud. It was awesome.
Sounds magnificent.
So we'll see if that happens. We'll mark that down for a bucket list.
Yeah, total bucket list. I see it happening.
Yeah. What is your favorite book?
Ooh, I would have to say. Well, so I've been reading a lot of, like, I'm really big on self-help books. So I have a couple. I love Brené Brown. I worship the ground she walks on. Daring Greatly is my favorite of hers. Mm-hmm. I also have to say, oh my God, it just like went out of my head. Oh, The Universe Has Your Back, Gabby Bernstein.
Okay.
Worship her. That book changed my life. And then there was another book. Oh my God. And I'm forgetting the name of it. Well, I'm reading Untamed right now by Glennon Doyle and it is phenomenal. There are so many great nuggets in it and I highly recommend it to any human being out there. It is, I have been quoting her in my Facebook group. I have been talking to her about the book to so many of my friends. So right now I would have to say like, that's on my nightstand and I am obsessed with it. So I can't think of the other book. There's one other book that like I really loved that I remember reading and recommended and now it's escaping me.
We're going to have to swap lists because that is like my jam too. I like
that. Oh, awesome.
Jen Sincero is my life changer. You're a badass.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I haven't read that one. Isn't that funny? Like, that's one I haven't read. Oh, and The Four Agreements. Hello.
Oh, I haven't read that one. I haven't heard that one.
Oh, Nicole. The Four Agreements.
I'm writing this down. The Four Agreements. Okay.
Yeah, it's a little teeny book, and I'm forgetting the name. Ruiz is the last name of the author. It's actually in my bookcase.
I'm an Audible type person too, like the audible.com. So I love listening to the books. I would rather read them, But if I read them, that means I have to sit. So like, if I sit enough in front of the computer, I like to walk or,
Yes.
you know, do my workouts and listen to
Yeah.
books or podcasts and whatnot.
Yeah. And I mean,
Oh,
I'm a huge, I
definitely.
just finished Girl, Stop Apologizing. I actually did that on Audible. I drove to visit my mom for Mother's Day and listened
Nice.
to the entire book to and from because she, I'm in LA. They live in San Francisco. We drove. So I listened to that on Audible. It was freaking awesome. She has a great, you know, it also takes like a certain voice to be able to listen to too. Rachel
Yes.
Hollis is phenomenal because she's also a speaker.
Mm-hmm.
So the way that she does her Audible books, it's like you're listening to her on a stage. So she's very animated. She's very engaging. Girl, Wash Your Face was another one I listened to on
Yeah.
Audible, which was great. So
I
yeah,
did
I
read that
love
one.
reading.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's funny that you said that about Audible because my very first book was The Hunger Games that I bought on Audible. And no offense to the lady reading it, but it was horrible. Like her voice, I didn't even finish it. I couldn't finish
Yeah.
it at all. So I'm grateful
Oy.
for people that like Jensen Shear, she read her own book, which I love. She's very New York, Jewish accent, kind of like
Yep.
in your face type. That's what I resonate with. Yeah. So I definitely, you gotta get a good book with the right person reading it for sure.
Yeah,
Yeah. So we're
definitely.
gonna
I
have to swap
agree.
lists.
Absolutely.
All right,
No
so
overlap.
no overlap. What is your favorite movie?
Of all time,
Mm-hmm.
the Wizard of Oz.
You're the second guest that I've had on that's their favorite. Very cool.
Yeah, and my favorite quote from the movie is, "You've always had the power, my dear. You just had to learn it for yourself."
Well, you just stole the last question, Wendy. Because what was your favorite inspirational quote?
Oh, it's that one.
Yeah. Can you say
Yes.
it again?
It's Glinda. She says, "You've always had the power, my dear. You just had to learn it for yourself."
Yeah, that is so true. I don't think we realize, I know for me personally, on my, I don't know if you want to call it philosophical journey, but like I never realized the thoughts that were in my head and how powerful they are and how, like, and it sounds very wooey, like very out there, but it's just amazing. Like, I feel like we have just tapped into like the smallest percentage of our brain as human beings. Like, I
Yes.
feel like there's so much more that we need to learn and that's
I
available to
agree.
us.
I agree.
All right. So, if you can quickly give like three takeaways for anybody that is going through divorce, and then we'll sign off.
Sure. I mean, first and foremost, ask for help if you're struggling. It's, you know, so many of us think that it is a weakness to raise our hand and say that we need help, and it's not, especially when you're going through something this hard. You need to be around people who can support you. And our friends and family are wonderful, but they try to move us out of the feelings when you really get to sit with them. And that takes people around you that understand what's going on. So ask for help. And I mean, that could be a therapist, it could be a counselor, it could be clergy, it could be a life coach, right? Just ask for help. There's a lot of resources available. You shouldn't do this alone. My second tip is, in that same vein, is, you know, allow yourself to feel what comes up. You know, so many times we try to push it away, we punish ourselves, like, stop feeling this way, or, you know, get over yourself, which drives me nuts because you get to feel what comes up. You know, you could be laughing one minute and crying the next, and laughing the next, and then crying again. And sometimes you just need to sit with it. And, you know, what I tell my clients sometimes is just set a timer and let yourself go, but make a declaration that once that timer goes off, you're done. So
Yeah.
let it through, let it go so that you can get through it and feel through it, right? That's what I say a lot. And then the last thing is, you know, to really take care of yourself. You know, we talked, this is kind of the theme and what I always leave people with, but self-care gets to be as simple as breathing, deep breathing for 5 minutes, right? In for four or three and then out, right? Breathe through the tension, breathe through the places in your body where you feel the tension. It can be meditating, it can be journaling, it can be taking a walk, it can be dancing, it can be drawing. Just give yourself at least 5 minutes a day to just detach from your head and just to be with yourself, nurture yourself, whatever that looks like. You deserve it, and you're going to be a better person for everybody in your life if you do that.
I think you brought some really brilliant diamonds in this podcast today.
Thank you. Oh, you're so sweet.
Thank you so much for being on. And
my pleasure.
Oh, you're very welcome. And anybody, like I said, who's listening, you can head to shapeitupfitness.com, get all the show notes. You can connect with Wendy and she will help you out. All right. Mm-hmm. That is all for me today. So make sure you listen into the next podcast and I will talk to you soon. Hey, if you're loving this podcast, I want to hear from you. Head over to the Apple Podcast and scroll all the way down at the bottom of the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. Please write a review. I can't wait to see what you write. Once you're done with your review, head over to shapeitupfitness.com and find out how you can get started on losing the weight for the last time.